will be 4.5 foot further forward. So everything else, and particularly the conveyor, has to move forward as well. That's the job of the afternoon shift. The furniture removers, some of us call them.
Their job is rather like rolling up a carpet, but it's a lot harder to do. First, the conveyor belting will be broken into sections and rolled clear. Then the rollers and structure will be shifted forward towards the face. Finally, the belt will be relayed. It looks easy enough, but it takes the best part of 6 hours to complete the whole change, all the way along the face. Another job that will be done on this shift is packing. As you drive your coal face forward, you can't afford to leave an unsupported space behind you. During the day shift, props were erected. Now these are withdrawn, and in their place, permanent packs are built to support the roof, one every 7 yards. And when the furniture removers have done their work, the whole face is ready for the night shift. The drillers and cutters, remember them? That's how the three-shift system works at this pit. Look at it again, in diagram this time. First, the night shift. Shot holes are drilled, and the coal is undercut. At some pits, cutting is done first before drilling. Next, the morning shift, Jack Scott's shift. Shot firing and filling. And so it goes on until the coal face has been driven forward 4.5 feet. Lastly, the afternoon shift, the furniture removers. The conveyor is shifted forward. This is called turning over. Packs, built every 7 yards, hold up the roof as the face advances. So the afternoon shift builds new packs. There it is in a nutshell. Night, drilling and cutting. Morning, shot firing and filling. Afternoon, turning over and packing.
Well, we don't do so bad. On an average, we get 300 tons of coal off our face each shift. That's about 12 tons a man. The conveyor takes it to the loading point. We passed that on our way in, as you remember.
The coal is loaded into the tubs, which will carry it to the surface. These tubs are lashed to the haulage rope and pulled by it from the loading point to the pit bottom. All traffic converges on the pit bottom. During the day shift, a continuous stream of full tubs is sent from there to the surface. As the full tubs go in one side of the cage, the empties, which have been sent down from the surface, come out the other and are sent back to the main haulage road to be filled again. All through this shift, the tubs are bringing the coal out from the 5 different faces to the pit bottom. It's vital that the roads along which they travel are kept in good order. Because of the severe pressure which is pushing these roads out of shape, there's always repair and maintenance going on in the pit. The displaced rock is torn away and the new roof supported by steel arches. The manager of a colliery is always about somewhere. Mr. Nelson is the manager at Hilton, Maine, and he'll stop to discuss every variety of work that's going on. But apart from supervising the day-to-day running of the pit, he is also responsible for planning for the future.
All the plans are examined and discussed by the Pit Consultative Committee. On it are representatives of the management and the men. Everyone in the pit has his spokesman. The face workers, men like Jack Scott, are represented by Arthur Richards. Jack Fletcher puts the point of view of the haulage men. And Les Garrett watches the interests of all the colliery tradesmen. Ken Hale is one of the younger generation. He speaks for the surface engineers. We're planning ahead to work distant seams which we know contain over 60 million tons of coal, enough to last 150 years at the present rate of output. The first essential is a new haulage road. We're making a start by driving it along here and across the existing main haulage road. This is where we've got to so far. They're working there now.
They're blasting and hacking their way through solid rock. Every week, they drive 12 yards through that wall towards what lies beyond. And that's not only more coal. It's a reorganized pit with new mechanical aids for getting the coal and hauling it to the surface. And with new roads as roomy and clean as a city subway, so that Jack Scott and his mates will be able to travel to and from their work by train. This already happens in some pits. It's what they're aiming at in Hilton, Maine.
But at present, and for a few years to come, I reckon, we'll still have to walk. When we pack up, it's early afternoon. And at the end of a tough shift, that walk seems a lot harder and longer than it did in the morning. It's grand to get above ground again and to get yourself cleaned up. After a hard shift, a hot shower's a treat. It freshens you up, you know. And means you can go home from work as clean as you were when you set out. At the Pithead canteen, you can get anything from a cup of tea to a full meal. And you can have a chat with your workmates, too. More often than not, we find ourselves talking about what we do in our spare time. It's surprising how many different hobbies there are, among even the few fellows you know really well. I don't know whether you'd call being a union secretary a hobby, but if it is, then it's one that don't leave you no time to yourself. From the moment Albert Parks comes out of the pit, people are asking him for help and advice. Even when he gets home, he has visitors on union business. Of course, Albert Parks is getting on a bit now, but there's plenty of young fellows just as keen to spend their leisure time in union or local government service. Take Jack Greenaway, for instance. He's a member of the Pitt Consultative Committee. He's just turned 30, and he's already chairman of his parish council. In our parish, the Pitt plays its part, all right. We've a fine old church, and every one of the bell ringers is a miner. My father among them. George Allen, who still works at the colliery, is the organist. Music for Arby, I suppose, is common enough. But you don't come across so many artists. Albert Appleby has been painting ever since he was a young lad. Pretty well, I reckon, since he first went down the pit at 15. My hobby's my family. There's nothing I like better than getting home after shift for a sit-down and a meal. Then, often enough, young Desmond and I go shooting together. We're right in the heart of the country where we live, and I like it. But it's different from most pit villages in more ways than one. Here, you'll make your own recreations. But in most mining areas, you'll find an institute where there's nothing to worry about except the way you're going to enjoy yourself.
These institutes were founded by the Miners' Welfare Commission and are governed by a committee of local men. They are for the whole family. Up and down the country, in dozens of different districts, miners and their folk come together at their institute and enjoy themselves. There are games to suit every taste and season. At one place, they've even built their own swimming pool. And of course, there's often the brass band, which is so common a feature of mining communities. At some of the larger institutes, there is a concert hall and games room. Saturday night's the night when everyone brings his wife or girlfriend along for a dance and a sing-song. Large or small, every institute has this in common, that every evening of the week, there's something happening. It may be the youth club, with its variety of activities run by local minors. Maybe the Women's Institute evening. Or it may be the Drama Club meeting. And if there are any Welshmen about, it's almost certain that one evening will be given over to the Institute choir. There's always something going on. These institutes are the center of every mining community. Whilst the fun goes on, the wheels are turning above ground and below ground all the time. While some miners play, others work. Coal getting continues all round the clock.